Welcome, everybody. In episode 28, we take a look and see just how many fees the railroads can squeeze out of their customers.
This is Railroad Showcase. Demurrage comes from the French word demeurer, which means to stay or linger. Originating in...
Before we get any farther, you're saying demurrage, but I've heard it pronounced demurrage. So which is right?
Demurrage.
Well, but, okay, you say that, but the people in the industry are the ones who get to choose, right, when they say it. And I've heard it said demurrage a lot.
The dictionary definition of pronunciation, maybe not the definition, but the way the dictionary says to pronounce it, and also based off of the way that the original French word that it is based off is pronounced, it is demurrage.
Demurrage.
So it originated in vessel chartering, which the term came to mean a type of charge from the ship owner to the shipper or the charterer. Essentially, if a person chartering the vessel took too long to get from one step to another, such as unloading and returning the vessel, the owner could charge them demurrage. This term is well established in railroading, going back over 100 years. According to Forbes, only 30% of the rail cars we see going down the tracks are owned by the railroads, meaning the other 70% are either owned or leased by shippers who use the railroads. Commonly, demurrage is introduced when shippers take too long to load or unload a car at a facility, using up time and trackage. In principle, this practice is good, encouraging quick, efficient use of resources and keeping things moving, which benefits not just the railroads, but the other shippers too. Recently, however, many customers of nearly all Class 1 railroads in North America have been complaining about how demurrage has been practiced in recent years.
In May, the STB, the Surface Transportation Board, had a hearing on the subject, requiring a representative from all Class 1 railroads and inviting anyone interested in submitting a report to do so. STB Chairman Ann Biegman, in her opening comments, talked about hearing of new, modified, and increased charges, stating that these charges have become increasingly significant and in some instances have curtailed or even foreclosed business opportunities. The STB agrees that demurrage and accessory charges can be useful. But after many reports of grievances, they question its current implementation.
One railroad, which in 2013 charged $50 a day for congestion, now charges $200, all while reducing the turn time for the cars from 48 to 24 hours. This means that if a shipper with a 72-hour turn rate brought in a 100-car train, instead of paying $5,000 for one day of demurrage, they now pay $40,000 for two. The railroads defend these charges, saying it's both good for the railroads and shippers, citing the aforementioned principle behind it, to keep things moving efficiently. The thing is, it doesn't seem to be helping. Shippers claim that it does nothing to ease the congestion, nor improve shipping time. In fact, they feel that there are times when it actually hinders time and wastes resources, specifically the shippers. Many shippers have also had to bear the personal expense of hiring auditors for the sole purpose of investigating these charges, because so often they have been over or wrongly charged. Other companies have had to build or expand rail yards to avoid these fines, and some smaller companies face a crisis from being unable to handle the demurrage. Yet, when asked about why the Class 1s don't charge each other demurrage, despite the transfer of cars from one railroad to another being one of the biggest bottlenecks in shipping, they didn't want to talk about it.
Some people claim that this is just a cash grab, but the railroads are quick to cite that income from demurrage only makes up 1 to 3% of their annual earnings. Just adding this to the list of accommodations for the benefits of precision scheduled railroading. And while it's true that these fines don't make up even a large portion of the railroad's annual income, it's not chump change they're pulling in with these fines. CSX generated a total of $365.7 million in demurrage and accessorial revenue. Norfolk Southern came in at $335 million. And with the exception of Kansas City Southern, the rest of the railroads all came in well over $200 million each, totaling over $1.2 billion in fees for the railroads.
So where's the line? Well, the STB hasn't yet decided to do anything one way or another. They did question why all these fees and charges are necessary, and why they couldn't operate more like they did in the past, or as others, like Kansas City Southern, are currently doing. Whether it's going to change anytime soon is unlikely, but even if stockholders are happy with the numbers coming in, eventually, practices like this could severely impact these railroads. The railroads might be the best or only option for some shippers, which leaves them in a corner. But extended periods of dissatisfaction are historically harmful to the long-term future of companies.
Railroad stocks are all over the place right now. Wall Street seems to like precision scheduled railroading, but how long can that party last? MarketWatch.com ran a subtitle that said, Union Pacific stock is the second biggest gainer in the S&P 500, while CSX shares suffer the worst two-day performance in a decade. TheStreet.com talked about fears among uncharacteristic declines in the normally stable railroad sector. NASDAQ.com said, U.S. stock indexes retreated for the second day on Wednesday as weak results from CSX Corp pressured railroad stocks and highlighted the wide-ranging impact of the protracted trade war between the United States and China.
After the Department of Justice unsealed indictment charges, Zudong William Yao is in hiding, wanted on charges of 9 counts of theft of trade secrets. Yao, 57, was hired in 2014 at an American locomotive manufacturer, and within the first 2 weeks of working at the facility, stole more than 3,000 classified files, many being copies of source code for the engine's operating system, and the accompanying manuals for the code. Over the next 6 months, Yao continued to download numerous other files, all being proprietary and containing trade secrets. Before being fired in 2015 for reasons other than the theft, Yao reportedly accepted a job in China that specializes in automotive telematics. A warrant was put out for Yao in 2017, but he has yet to be apprehended and is believed to be hiding in China. After the Missionary Ridge fire that struck Durango in 2002, it took years for the tourist industry to recover. This year, however, despite only having the 416 fire last year, things seem to be back on track. During the 4th of July weekend, the hotels in Durango averaged out at 96% capacity, and while overall ridership for the Durango and Silverton narrow gauge is down for the year after a wet winter, they have met their 2017 numbers for summer ridership and are looking to exceed those. The railroad has done a few things to encourage the return of riders, such as starting a new 2-hour trip from Rockwood to Cascade, and a new brew train on Saturday, which features lunch, live music, and of course, beer.
The Grafton and Upton Railroad in Grafton, Massachusetts, is filing for eminent domain to acquire land next to its tracks. The land, 155 acres of wooded area and wetland, is listed under Mr. Morneau and Mr. Nagel, trustees of the 140 Realty Trust. The railroad has tried for the last 9 months to buy the land, met with firm refusal despite claiming to offer a fair market value for the property. According to some appraisers, the land is valued at just under $500,000, though the owners feel it should be more. The railroad claims that the land is unusable for virtually any purpose and that they would only develop the uplands, leaving the wetlands. If they get the green light to proceed, they will still have to pay the appraised fair market value. Interestingly, the HopeDale local news mentioned that this isn't the first attempt on the part of the railroad to use eminent domain to get property, the previous time being fought in a lawsuit.
So, again, this is an interesting find. It's never a favorite when something tragic happens. In 2009, there was an accident in Croatia, the worst the country had ever seen as far as rail traffic. The derailment was caused by a runaway train, which was unable to slow down due to residue that was left on the rails from a new fire retardant that was sprayed along the rails about 10 minutes before. This video was shot shortly after that wreck, where we see a maintenance vehicle coming down the tracks facing the same slick rails as the wrecked train. This is just a perfect example of how easy it is for something small to make a huge difference when all the details aren't checked. Not only was there loss of life with the passengers, there was nearly another loss of life, all due to the fact they didn't know the new retardant would cause the rails to be slick, since that had never been an issue before.
In our next favorite find, we're going to talk about rail safety. We are going to be instructed on rail safety by Larry the Cable Guy. It's serious business when pedestrians are on the tracks, and he gives us just the advice we need to prevent injury.
I mean, it ain't like it's going to swerve and miss you at the last minute. You know what I mean? You got the tracks right there, kind of giving you a little heads up something may be happening and in this area right here. You know, ain't like it's going to pop out from behind the bushes. You know what I'm saying? If you ever get attacked by a train, do this.
We love Jurassic Park here, from the story to the way that they brought the movie to life, to the technical aspect of doing so, and just the fact that dinosaurs are really, really cool. And so what makes dinosaurs even cooler? You add a train to it. This one just happens to be built out of Legos.
We've been doing for a long time, and we finally got it put together, and it's here. It is a bit of a collaborative one because we built the train, but James Ritzman did do the fences and the gate, and Bob Day supplied all the greenery and every single dinosaur you see here.
That's good because you got a few different builders from the show involved.
Yes, absolutely. Specifically because I don't have this many dinosaurs, this variety or this quantity. So Bob was a big part of making this happen for sure.
So we want to start with the train. Maybe you can stop it real quick and we can jump into a little more detail on, you know, how that came together and the kind of how that is built.
Absolutely, yeah. So the original inspiration for the train engine here is the Jurassic Park Ford Explorer tour, right? And so the idea was to make it look like the Explorer, have a big window, you know, those had that big bubble, you know, sunroof on the top. So this is a Slave One cockpit window, used to make it a nice big glass window on the front there, armored just like the trucks were and everything, same coloring as the trucks, just really to look like that tour car that we saw, right? And then going on to the tram cars, which Andy made, those were
basically, yeah, we saw the Jeeps and I like the color scheme. I think we can make a tram,
kind of hide the wheels, make a tram car like a Universal Studios backlot kind of tram. And once one was made, you can make multiples. So made four for this time. We have other thoughts of how to change it, but
there are custom like decals on there as well, right?
There are. Yeah, I did a little Photoshop and then had some friends print it out and stick them on. And we have more and more ideas, but this was the way it was for this one, and we like it. It translates well as a tram car and kind of want to go on the backlot tour, right?
Sure, it gives that kind of idea.
This video is by the channel Behind the Brick in an interview with the builders at the Bricks Cascade Exposition. We'll never be the same twice.
We're going to go back in time now to 1949, and we're going to listen to the radio, and one of the top songs that's playing is Run for the Roundhouse, Nellie by Peggy Lee. To set the mood, this song opens with the classic big band steam train sound effects.
Have you ever heard the story old timers tell about a locomotive called O'Neill?
It's an upbeat ballad about a rather sobering subject. An engine named Nell has become a runaway. And the premise of the song is that the engineer is talking, or rather pleading with the engine, to head for the roundhouse instead of over a cliff. The singer Peggy Lee was huge in her day with numerous number one hits. She performed with the likes of Glenn Miller, Perry Como, Mel Torme, Frank Sinatra, Jimmy Durante, and Nat King Cole. She also had a successful acting career. She even did the voices for the Siamese Cats in Lady and the Tramp.
It's in the cards. There'll be a new back door in the roundhouse and a new track leaving the yard. On through the fields.
Railroading is still part of our cultural consciousness today, but really nothing quite like it was back then. The Capitol record label approved the release of a song that used such terminology as section foreman, double heading, yard tracks, and right-of-way, knowing that a large portion of the public would have a basic understanding of these concepts.
One more run, we got a pension due, and the way she's rolling, Ellie knows it too. Some cattle crossing on the track that day, they had no business on the right-of-way. A lone cow punched us at and shook his fist, crying, come back, Nellie, there's a heifer you missed.
If you want to find out how the song ends, you can follow the link in our show notes for episode 28 at rrshowcase.com.
It's nice to see that Popular Mechanics is carrying on their long history of railroad coverage. Last week, they released an article that gave a good overview of the modern life of the 4449. There are some photos from the 1970s restoration that portray the hard work and hard conditions. Then, the article wraps up with spectacular shots of more recent runs. Bravo to Popular Mechanics! You can read this article online. Link is in the show notes. All right, that's the end of episode 28 this week. Thank you guys for being here. Remember, we'll be back Monday with more news, features, and favorite finds.
Thanks for watching. Keep your hand on the throttle and your eye on the rail.